Oi there, Jim lad. The red dust bodes well for the day's sail. I be plundering the seven seas, pillaging the natives for spice, and scouring the foul wenches IGs looking for me booty. Climb aboard, ye landlubber, though we be in for some rough waters ahead. Davy Jones took one of me eyes, harpooning the giant Cardassian Kraken. Ye be forewarned. Hoist the mainsail and scuttle the jib. Join me mateys as we continue the quest for Blackbeard's treasure. Amass your copy of the Butt Builder Bundle today.
MapsFitnessProducts.com.
Yarr.
If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
That was Google Spanish.
Wow.
Este episodio de Mind Pump.
Oh.
That's Spanish for in this episode of motherfucking Mind Pump.
What? Wow.
Boom. For the first 35 minutes, we do our introductory conversation. We started by talking about our early weed experiences. That's right.
Yeah.
Which one of us tried the weed first?
Tried the weed.
The weed. The devil's lettuce.
Got the wub wubs.
The giggle bush.
The devil's lettuce.
Giggle bush. Then, the next thing we talked about was the big PRX Performance Black Friday sale.
Hooking you up.
Now, PRX Performance makes those awesome racks that fold into your wall. Justin has one. They're super convenient.
You know you want one.
Super sturdy and now super on sale. If you go to prxperformance.com/mindpump and use the code mindpump, you'll get 5% off a free MAPS Prime purchase. As a program with the purchase of $500 or more. And the Black Friday special is another $50 to $100 off each rack and a free gift. I like the free gift part. Then we talk about the origin of Black Friday. Why do they call it Black Friday? How did it start? And then, of course, Four Sigmatic is also having a Black Friday sale. If you go to foursigmatic.com/mindpump and use the code mindpump, you'll get 15% off on top of the already
plus
Black Friday discounts, which are already 20 to 50% off. So it's massive. Then we talk about obesity and how it affects your mind. Some studies are showing that just being obese will also cause depression independent of the psychological factors. It's actually physiologically potentially causing depression.
I'm fat and sad.
Then we get into the questions. The first question was, when putting on muscle, what's better? 5 days a week of isolation work, AKA the bro split, or 3 days of full body lifting? Which one's going to put the most muscle on me?
I think you know the answer.
Next question. If or when would you ever use a hex bar over a straight bar for deadlifts? A hex bar is also known as a trap bar. Which one is better for what? When do you use a trap bar? When do you use a straight bar? Or should you just use them both and be a badass?
Whoa, at the same time.
The next question is, this person wanted to know our opinions on weight belts and wrist wraps. Do they help you build more muscle, or do they just help you build your ego?
Yeah, you look silly.
And the final question, when you're trying to figure out your maintenance calories, do you do the average of the week, or do you do it per day? And also, what do you do about weight that fluctuates daily? This person's body weight tends to fluctuate daily. What does this mean, and what can they do?
Ooh, you probably have to pee.
Finally, Black Friday is here. All individual MAPS programs, 50% off. All bundles, 25% off. That's right, all of them, everything.
Holy Chronopolis.
This is literally the biggest Black Friday sale we've ever done in our entire lives.
Ever.
I'm excited.
You have to go to MAPSFitnessProducts.com, and you have to use the following codes. If you want 50% off the individual programs, use BF programs. That's B as in boy, F as in fart. Programs. If you want the 25% off the bundles,
he had to.
You got
to
click on the bundles and use BF bundles. B is in butt, F is in fart. Bundles. Sorry, all going. One word. BF bundles. Go check them out again. They're
boom,
at
boom, MAPS,
MAPSFitnessProducts.com. Did you guys ever do that when you were kids, or you like tried to be rebellious? You're like, let's smoke a fucking napkin, dude. All right.
Oh, yeah.
You ever did that?
The dumbest.
I smoked a banana peel.
You actually did that?
I heard it was a thing.
I heard it was a thing, too. Is it real?
It made me so sick.
How did you smoke it? You dried it?
Dried it out, yeah. It dried it out, and then we just we packed it in this bowl, and we smoked it like idiots. And I got really sick, and my head hurt for like, I remember like a whole day.
Are you kidding me?
No.
I heard that that was a thing too, that if you smoked banana peels, yeah, it was supposed to be some crazy.
I might as well have eaten paint chips while I was at it.
That probably would have given you a better high.
Yeah.
I did oregano out of a Bic pen.
You actually smoked oregano?
Out of a Bic pen.
That's otherwise.
So I literally inhaled plastic and oregano.
Wow.
Wait a minute. You lit a Bic. Healthy. You put a lighter on a Bic.
So
Bic
we took the, you know, imagine a Bic pen.
Oregano's that, by the way, that's Italian weed. Yeah. Just want you to know that.
It is.
We took out
oregano.
We took out the inside and then we melted down the end of it a little bit so it made this little scoop in a bowl. And then we put the oregano on there.
Wow. You know,
that was the dumbest thing we ever did.
Ingenious.
The first time I was a kid. The first time I ever tried
the fuck I was doing
marijuana, I was probably, let me think, 15, 16. I was like 16 years old. And you know how we smoked it? By the way, kids.
Apple core.
Yeah, no. No, I didn't
That's
go that
how
far.
I did it.
By the way, for those of you listening who are young, back in when I was 16, it was really illegal.
Really illegal.
So very illegal. I was like, this was a big deal. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We had a, we did a paper, toilet paper roll. Remember how to do that?
Oh, yeah.
So you take the toilet paper tube.
You mean like a bong?
You cut out a little square out of the top. Then you get tin foil and you create a bowl. Wow. And then you poke holes in the tin foil. And then you put the weed in the bowl, and then you plug the other end of the toilet paper bowl and light the top.
Oh, I kind
of
want to try this.
That's like a really sad pipe.
It was.
It's like a cheap bong.
Yeah. And we did it, me and my friend, and I was like all nervous and shit, and felt nothing at all.
Yeah, because like none of it's airtight.
I don't know what it was. I don't know if it was garbage or what.
Yeah.
But I felt nothing. But of course, when you're a kid, you're like, dude, do you feel it? Oh my God, I feel it. You know?
Do you remember?
By the way,
the Apple one works though.
Sort of the toilet paper roll one. But do you know why I know I didn't feel it?
Mm.
Because I thought I felt it. Because again, we were laughing. Oh my God, I'm so high. Feel it. It was, I don't know, a few months later, I'm with my girlfriend, my girlfriend's friend, and my girlfriend's friend's boyfriend. So it's four of us. And we're in my girlfriend's friend's boyfriend's car. He had the first car, right? So we're driving, and he was a big weed smoker. So he pulls out a pipe. He's like, "Hey, you guys want to smoke some weed?" And I'm like, "Oh my God, I tried it once. You know, I got high. It was so funny." So he's like, "Yeah, here, try this one." So now I had a legit pipe, and now I think I'm the fucking.
Here comes the real stuff.
I think I'm the shit, right?
You're experienced.
So I hit it hard, right? So I took one big ass hit, and then I took another.
You ever been wet?
Big ass. Exactly. I took another big ass hit, and I remember taking the hit, putting the pipe down, and then I literally did this. So if you're sitting next to me, this is what I did. Oh. And I sat back in my chair.
That's like that one meme where the skeleton's like sitting back here. Just,
yeah, exactly.
Like dead.
Dude, that sound you did.
That's
the sound you hear. What is that?
That's the sound your brain makes when you have too much weed.
You're in the too much weed zone.
That was exactly what I heard.
You hear the earth humming or something.
Like, what is that?
Maybe that's what it is.
That's what it is.
That's what it is. You're so high, you hear the...
You're in tune with the spin of the the earth.
Dude, I was sitting back in the car and I'm just like, oh, and then everybody's like, well, you feel it? And I'm like, yeah, I think I feel it.
I can't talk.
Then we're driving to 7-Eleven and I'm telling my girlfriend like quietly in the back because I'm paranoid as fuck at this point. And I'm looking at her, I'm like, hey, I'm like, put your hand right here. She puts her hand on my chest. I'm like, do you feel my heart?
Am I still breathing?
Do you feel my heart beating? I can't feel my heart beating.
Yeah.
So I'm taking my pulse, feeling my heart, taking my pulse. We stop at the 7-Eleven. I'm like, I can't get out. I have to stay inside the car. So I stayed in the car. Everybody got their snacks. I don't know. An hour and a half later, time to go home. I'm fucking blazed out of my mind. So I'm afraid of walking to my house.
Yeah.
Walk up to my door, and there's like five cars parked outside of my house. So I'm like, oh, my grandparents, my aunts, and my uncles are here.
Oh, my God.
This is good.
Yeah.
So I walk in, and I'm fucking high as hell, but paranoid to shit.
Yeah.
So I say hi to – because, you know, my family – you can't just walk. I can't walk in and go.
Did you do the Visine? Like, were you all?
Dude,
like,
you have to walk in and you have to give everybody a kiss. You have to say hi to everybody.
Wow.
So I'm saying hi to everybody and I'm just got this straight face, and I'm giving everybody, and I'm like, okay, I'm going to go up to my room now. And I walk up to my room, and my mom walks up there, and she's like,
does she know?
She's like, hey, see, here's the thing about my parents. My parents are way more privy now, but I was the firstborn. These are Sicilian immigrants, and my mom was so sheltered and from her with her dad that I could probably throw weed in the air and they wouldn't know what it was, right?
Yeah.
So my mom just comes up. So she's innocent, you know. She just comes up. She's like,
"What's wrong, me, huh?
Yeah, are you okay, honey? Is everything okay?
You're acting a little different."
Yeah, and you know when you're so paranoid that if somebody questions you enough, you're gonna just fucking spill the beans. You know what I'm saying? No matter what. She's like, "Are you okay, honey?" And I'm like, "Yeah, I'm okay." And she's like, "Are you sure?" And she looks at me, and I'm like, I think my friends were smoking weed, and I smelled some of it, and I think I maybe felt it. I made up some bullshit.
Blame it on all your friends.
Secondhand high.
Man, you were that friend. Then I come over to your house later on that week, and your mom's
looking at
me. It was Adam. Yeah.
Your mom's looking at me.
She's like, did it. The same friend that left the condoms in your car? Yeah. It's him.
Him. Guy.
The guy that left cigarettes out. Yes. Yeah, all that stuff.
A terrible influence.
I know. He comes from that dysfunctional family. I don't want you hanging out with kids like that anymore.
Sorry, I pulled the same move, Sal.
Did you? No, you didn't.
I threw my friend Joe under the bus a few times.
How did you? Yeah. What did you, for what?
Yeah, same thing. Like, they came in, like I was with my parents. Actually, I didn't go with them this time. They came down from, there's this spot where they would smoke, like, up the street. It was, like, in the woods. And my other friend lived close to me, and so they were all, you know, smoking. They came over because they knew my mom makes the best brownies. And so they're, like, coming over, like, hey, man. Like, they're, like, super stoned. And I'm like, dude, guys, you know, what are you doing? And they came in and they just reeked of marijuana. And my mom's friend was just like, you know, like, oh my God, like, just, you know, there must have been like some kind of like crazy hippie concert or whatever. She was like totally like trying to throw him under the bus and then telling that to my mom. And it was just like, I had to explain like all the time I would throw my friend Joe under the bus because like I would come home and like when I was stoned, like I would just be like, yeah, you know, I just was hanging out and then they started, you know, smoking. Like some of it, I breathed in some of it. And you know,
just a lie
my way through it. Just like through my teeth.
I got grounded for a month for smoking weed before I had even smoked weed. How fucked up is that?
You didn't smoke weed?
Didn't even. So this is high school. When I was in high school, anytime, of course, just like every other kid, anytime your parents took off, you know, for a weekend or whatever, like you're the house, that's the party at, right? So we threw a party at my house when my parents were out of town. Everything was fine. Clean. We made sure there was a day of separation in between them coming back so we could clean the shit out of the house and everything. We're good. Like nothing broken in the house. We're fine. And like a week later, and this was back when I used to work the dairy, so I'd get up like 3 o'clock in the morning. So I'm in the bathroom before school, you know, or before work. I'm brushing my teeth at 3 o'clock in the morning, getting ready to go to work. And my mom comes walking in, and I'm in the bathroom, and she slams this big ass bubbler on the counter. What the fuck is this?
Oh no!
Yeah, instantly like grounding me, and my eyes get like this big, and I'm like, you know, of course I don't know at first. But I'm like looking at it going like, that looks like my friend Ravens. You know, right? and she's like questioning me. I can't believe this. And blah, blah, blah. She's just berating me, right? And then she tells me that somebody left it up in the, like above the cabinet that you never get into, you know, like where the cookbooks are at, you know, that once a year the parents open the cabinets for or whatever like that. He put it above like the microwave cabinets up there and he got stoned and forgot about it. And so it had been in my house for like 2 weeks after the party. And then I go to school the next day, grounded for a month. I'm grounded for.
Think about it this way. You got grounded. You didn't get caught for the party, but you got grounded for something else. So you deserved it.
Yeah. Shit. That's exactly how it went down. Because then they're like, we know you had a party and stuff, right? No. So I was busted for everything. I was busted for
dude,
for
I
sure
got
having
drug
a party.
Tested. But my dad drug tested me.
What?
No way.
Yeah, when I worked at his
You're
place.
Like a goody two-shoes.
Yeah. And here's the thing. Like, my friends all did that too. And I was like, at the time I didn't smoke with them, but like maybe once a year, you know, and I would just pretend to do it just like Bill Clinton said, you know, like I literally pulled that move. I was like, oh, that's a move. I'm doing that, you know? And, so I was working and loading and unloading trucks for him over the summer. And he just like decided that, oh, actually it's new company policy. You need to get drug tested for this. And so like he went through a couple employees, but really just targeted me.
Oh, smart.
But found out that I didn't, you know, and so then he backed off forever. And then that's when I started smoking weed.
Because you got the green light.
Yeah, I got the green light. It's like I passed.
Oh my gosh, that's hilarious.
Yeah, it was crazy.
My fam, I remember having a talk with my mom in my late 20s. Like I was like 27, 28. We're sitting around a fire one night having wine, and we're talking about, you know, I think that's about the age that you get to when you can finally like share like high school bad stories, you know, with your mom. When you're still like 20, 21, it's still a little early.
Oh, it's still a little, yeah.
Right. So I'm like 27-ish or whatever, and I'm talking to my mom about all this stuff, and she's telling me all the times I got caught with girls and all this shit that, you know, whatever, and parties. And, you know, my mom like really believed that I smoked weed, and she's just like, oh, yeah, we knew you smoked weed. I said, Mom, I didn't smoke weed in high school. She's just like, yeah, yeah, right. You know what I'm saying? We knew. We saw this and we heard this. And I'm like, no. The first time I really smoked weed wasn't until I was in my 20s. And her and I went back and forth forever. She's like, why the fuck would I lie to you? I'm a grown-ass man in my own place. Like,
I don't care anymore.
What does it serve me to lie to you? I was like, no, really, I never did. And then she was asking questions about that time. And I said, no, that was... I had a party and I had friends over and I had lots of friends that smoked weed. I mean, it was very, very common that people did smoke weed. I didn't. And so she just did not believe me for the life of me. She also thought I wasn't a virgin as a high school kid because I had been caught with my girlfriend and stuff like that and fooling around and doing shit like that. So they just assumed I was going all the way. And I'm like, no, I was like, man, see how much you guys were fucked up, man.
Yeah.
I didn't have
you got
sex.
In trouble
I didn't
for a bunch of shit.
Yeah, yeah, I was such a good kid. You guys were so hard on me. Made her feel guilty.
Jesus Christ. Do you remember the first time you tried?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I told you that story.
Which one?
First time I smoked weed?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was when I was 20. I'd came back. I'd already.
Is that the time you got so high you got scared?
Yeah.
So the very, very first time.
Very first time was when I was in my 20s. I'd already moved to San Jose. I'd already been a trainer, already making good money. That's how I justified it was.
This is when you were on the bed and you kept hearing the looping.
Oh, yeah. The whoop whoop whoop, the whoop 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 sound, and then
But did you guys experience this? Like, this was the first time I got really high. I was like on my friend's like back deck, and I had that the whoop whoops, and then on top of the whoop whoops, I had like literally it felt like, you know, at the end of a old school movie where the movie reels like it's in frames. Yeah. Like I was seeing like life going in like frames.
Yeah, that's how that.
Have you seen that before?
Well, that's what the repeating thing feels like.
Yeah, yeah, it's like a slideshow or something.
I laid down. I was so nauseous and dizzy and freaked out and paranoid that I laid down in my bed and like covered my head. And then people would come in the room to check on me, but the way it was playing in my head was it was repeating.
Uh-huh.
It kept happening, and it was like screens. Like it was like,
you know how many,
oh, man,
you know how many
was,
more
that
people
sucked. That was horrible.
That kept me from weed for so long.
I was done with weed after that.
What's funny is how many more people are going to have an experience like that now that the laws are loosening?
Yeah,
and people are like, oh, cool, it's all good. I heard it's safe. It's not going to kill you. I bet you there's a lot of people now having these experiences.
Well,
the dummy mistake
that I made was because I had heard up until that point people say things like, oh, you should try it because you won't even get high your first time. You'll see. You won't even get high.
I know. That's such a dumb myth.
Yeah. So people said some shit like that
to
me.
Like you have to smoke it more than once.
And so my attitude going into it was, okay, wrong. If I'm going to try this, I'm going to experience it. I'm with friends. I'm in my place. I'm in a total safe setting that I felt like, okay, let's push this. Let's get all the way high so I can experience this. And that was the stupidest thing I could ever do. And nobody coached me otherwise. Like, they just thought it was cool. Like, oh, look, Adam just keeps on going. This is cool. You know, let him get hell high.
He's really
going
to feel this.
Yeah, when you're the other guys, it's a blast, you know, to watch somebody get blitzed out of their mind like that. But for me, it was awful.
I can't believe listening to Hunter the other day talk about his first was salvia. I was like, are you crazy?
Yeah,
I've seen people do that, like,
I
turn
did.
Into crazy zombies.
In high school, I tried weed twice, maybe, and that one time that I got paranoid, that kept me away for a long time, and then I reintroduced it later on because of health issues and stuff like that, and the medicinal aspects, and I learned about it, but I never... There was one time, this was in my... God, I must have been in my late 20s. I was hanging out with my buddy, good friend of mine, and this guy is just a maniac. And he had some drug experience, but he was by no means a somebody who did drugs all the time or anything like that. He's just, I guess, what you would consider your average, you know, person that parties. Anyway, we went to a bar. He's like, dude, I got this supplement. He called it a supplement. And this is why he closed me. He goes, I got the supplement, mate. He goes, makes you feel fucking great. He's like, you got to try
love them supplements.
He said, you got to try it. It makes you feel great. And I'm like, makes you feel great. I'm like, what is it? And he goes, oh, I don't know what's in it. Some herbs or something. But man, you feel fucking amazing when you take it. So I'm like, okay. So we're at Santana Row, dude. It's like a Thursday night. We're not even supposed to be out that late. You know what I'm saying?
Ladies' night. Hey.
So we take it and we're hanging out and fucking, I don't know, 40 minutes later, man, I'm having the best conversation of all time. Next thing you know, I'm just like, bro, we're fucking, oh, goddamn, it's such a nice evening.
You want to do business with the guy?
Yeah. I'm like, yeah. I want to fucking work with you. Oh,
yeah.
And then his other friends came over and they're like, what are you guys on? He's like, oh, I gave him. I can't remember what the drug was. It was some of those designer fucking bath salts or some shit. But it was so funny because I had no idea, you know?
You don't even know what it was to this day?
It
had to have been like ecstasy or
something. It was like that, but it wasn't that, right?
It is, yeah, some artificial version.
Yeah, and I was just like, whoa, Mello, hey, what's up? Everybody was like, what's up? I'm hugging everybody. Yeah. And I felt like shit the next day.
Yeah.
It was terrible.
Yikes.
Yeah. I felt so bad the next day. Anyway, good times.
I have a hard transition for you guys. I saw that, Justin, you posted on the PRX the other day. I meant to tell you that because I get a chance with Taylor to get caught up with all of our supplements and our sponsors and stuff. And PRX actually made a point to let me know that when you do those posts, they get really good traction on the website. So the photos that you post and stuff, they really, and then they also have a good Christmas deal that's coming out.
Is it Black Friday?
Yeah.
Black Friday's crazy.
Yeah.
The promotions coming out are insane.
Everybody's
going all in this year. It seems like.
Well, I wrote down what's going on with PRX. Let's see. If you go to prxperformance.com/mindpump, the promo code mindpump, so you get 5% off the free MAPS programs, and then each rack is going to be discounted between $50 to $100 on top of it.
Wow.
Yeah, so there's going to be, and then
now's
there's like
the
a, and then I think there's a free gift.
Yeah, they haven't announced what the gift is, but they're going to be giving some sort of a free gift.
And here's the thing about weights and racks and stuff like that. The margins are small.
Yeah.
So the fact that they're doing $50 to $100.
It's a lot to ask. And this is why we haven't attached ourselves to many exercise equipment brands out there. Cause there's a lot of them to choose from, but this brand, it makes so much sense for, you know, myself and people in, you know, similar situations where you got kids or you got, you know, it's convenience is everything. Right. And just being able to have time to, create for yourself. Like it's such a time saving.
Well, especially with our anabolic program that doesn't require much equipment. I mean, if you have a squat rack, a barbell,
adjustable bench and dumbbells, you're done.
Yeah, you've got everything you need for that program. So it makes a lot of sense for them also. And then don't forget too, anybody who makes that purchase of $500 or more with them, we kick a program
we'll
too.
Throw it
MAPS Prime.
Yeah, that was part of the reason why we did that was because we knew that they couldn't discount stuff for very much just because the margins suck.
It's so funny. So I'm looking up the history of Black Friday, and I guess the Christmas shopping season where they were, you know, started after Thanksgiving didn't start becoming a thing until about 1952. But it wasn't until the 1980s that the term Black Friday was widely used.
Like there's like pandemonium somewhere. Like what was the catalyst for this?
It referred to basically because
tickle
of the amount of
the tickle me elmo.
Remember that shit?
That was like the first
tickle me elmo.
That's one of the ones I remember.
That was the first one that I remember that like became a thing where people, maybe it was just because the internet was starting to take off at that time, and so it was the first time somebody could get a present early and then flip it and resell it for 2-3 times the price to everybody.
No, but it's the largest shopping day of the year in America since 2005. That's what this is saying. So apparently more people spend more money in this one day of shopping than any other day.
Yeah, I feel like retail has just figured out like that was when everybody did the shopping was because you have the holiday where, you know, day after Thanksgiving is like, what else is everybody going to do? Well, either go to a movie or shop.
Well, this is a fantastic example of how businesses, without working with each other, kind of organize this thing. Because this whole Black Friday thing, all these retailers benefit from this being a frenzy.
Yeah.
Because people expect, you know, big promotions. And not only that, but because people are saving, they actually end up spending more because they go out and want to buy more, right?
Right.
So it becomes this huge thing that everybody promotes.
It's like the continuous going out of business sale.
Yeah. And then you've got retailers like Walmart that'll take like specific limited amounts of TVs, for example, and sell them at a loss. Yeah. Just to get people in the door. And that's when you see the fucking crowds.
No, it's I mean, look at Four Sigmatic's doing. I mean, they're
Four Sigmatic's our other sponsor doing a huge
They're adding
great promotions right
They're adding the Black Friday sale on top of our 15% off. And I think they're doing like 25 to 50 off of something. So if you're one of our listeners, you use a lot of the Four Sigmatic products.
It's already going to be on sale.
Right.
Use our code and get 15% off that on top of it.
Yeah.
So some of your products are going to be 35 to, when you combine the two, 35 to like 75% off if they have something that's 50% off.
Yeah, that's smart, man.
So it's pretty crazy. And this, Doug, if correct me if I'm wrong, this episode airs the day
before.
The day before Black Friday.
So we won't. Now, can we tell people?
Can we announce our own big deal?
I don't think we're going to announce what we're doing. We'll just announce that we are doing something. Right?
Just look out.
We can announce it.
We can announce everything. This is the biggest. So I can give the detail.
Yeah.
This is the biggest. We actually had a discussion and debate about this because it's.
We have never done this before.
This is the biggest promotion we've ever done.
Doug
ever.
Did not want to do this. You know how Doug is. He's hella stingy with our shit.
I'm really tight.
Yeah. Tight lipped Doug.
And then there's Sal. He just wants to give everything away.
Yeah, he's tight like a dolphin's ass. It's that's watertight.
It's not, I was going to say, they're pretty frisky. That's a bad example.
No, it's watertight. That's the point.
All right, gotcha.
It's literally the biggest sale we've ever done ever, and it's. Very, very short.
We're only doing it 24 hours, right, Doug?
It's going to be a little bit more than 24 hours because we're starting right now. When you're listening to this, it started.
But
right
it ends
at midnight tomorrow, which is Friday.
So midnight, Black Friday. After that, it's done.
All done.
After that, you're fucked.
So here's the promotion. Here you ready for this? Ready?
Give it to us.
Everything.
Everything's on sale?
Everything.
What?
All maps programs, every single individual maps program.
Like even the latest and greatest ones we've done?
All of them. Maps Anabolic, Maps Performance, Maps Aesthetic, Maps Anywhere, Maps Prime Pro, Maps Strong, Maps Split 50% off.
Hit.
Wow. Maps Hit, 50% off. But that's not all.
Well, wait, there's more.
There's more. All bundles, which are already discounted.
Yeah.
Are discounted further. How much more?
25% off.
All bundles are 25% off on top of the discounted price they already are.
Wow.
So there you go.
We swaddled our programs.
Somebody come restart my heart.
Yeah.
I just stopped.
Yeah. It's just one day.
Okay, and this is how you get it. BF programs will give you the 50% off the programs, and BF bundles. Give you 25% off the bundle.
BF as in like butt fart?
Like big fucking deal.
Or Black Friday.
Oh, Black Friday.
Butt fart.
Butt fart.
But thank you for that, Adam.
I wasn't sure.
That's like something my oldest kid.
They'll never forget it now.
Butt fart.
You know, I like that you have to say butt fart.
Because yes, dude.
It could be a, who knows where it could come from.
Yeah, you don't know where. Yeah, it could be a
could
mouth
be a
fart.
Could be a queef.
Yeah, queef fart. Nose fart.
But by the way.
Like, let's be specific.
Can we just, for a second, just
sorry.
One of my favorite words.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite words of all time.
What?
Queef.
Queef.
Oh. It's just a great word. Queef. It's just a great word.
One of my friends, he wasn't my friend. That was his nickname in high school.
What? So.
Yeah. I nominated it to him.
His nickname was Queef.
That's not what you want.
He earned it. Yeah. He definitely earned it. That's
why
all I'm gonna say.
What did you call him?
We'll just leave it at that.
Why was he called Queef?
I mean, I just didn't like him.
Oh,
but he earned it.
Such a bully, dude.
He earned it. Yeah.
Such a bully.
Who most likely to be a bully? We all know who that is.
Right, right.
Yeah, Justin.
They have programs in schools now because of guys like you.
Well, listen, you know why?
Listen, Linda.
Listen,
Linda.
He crossed me, you know. Like I was in metal shop, and like I built this whole like barbecue set, and I spent forever on it. Oh, I'm gonna borrow that for this weekend. I'm having a barbecue at the beach. Oh, cool. Yeah, cool guy. No problem. Yeah, you can borrow it. Never brought it back. Where's my barbecue? Never brought it back. So you know, there was an opportune time, like at one of the team dinners and whatever, and I just decided to drop that little. Nickname for him. And we had I would do that every time I walked by him.
No.
Anyways.
Oh,
it makes me sound like a really cool guy.
You guys remember the story of when I gave away the barbecue?
Yes.
Oh, that's a good time.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people listening to the show don't know. some of those early stories.
I know.
Because we only shared them
once.
That's
unfortunate, and if it's up that's to one of my favorites.
If it's up to Doug, we'd probably keep it that way.
Yeah. Yeah. So
we've evolved.
It's a good story, though, yeah, man.
Well, go back and listen to the old stories. Oh, right.
I'm not giving anybody nicknames anymore.
I won't tell them.
I'm just saying.
I won't tell them.
That was a different guy.
I'll bring up a science study. Sorry, if you wanted to hear my barbecue giveaway story,
you're going to have to go backtrack a few episodes.
You have to figure that out. No, I got another article for you guys. Here's a science article. So instead of a fun story, let's get sciencey.
All right, let's get to the sciencey.
There is growing evidence that obesity causes depression. Now, this new study that they've done is separating the potential depression that comes from just being obese, like, oh, I'm sad that I'm overweight, and the actual physical effects of the obesity causing inflammation, which then causes the depression itself. So they're finding in the study that obesity in and of itself contributes to poor mental states of mind.
Wow.
Pretty crazy, right?
From like a chemical perspective.
You know, this makes me wonder, not wonder, but this helps me realize what a difficult situation being in that state of health is, because it's a positive feedback loop. And I don't mean positive in the sense of it's a good feedback loop. I mean positive in the sense that let's say you're sad, depressed, or stressed, so you eat more, so you gain body fat, which then makes you more sad, depressed.
Reinforcing it over and over and over.
And it just accelerates and accelerates. You know what I'm saying?
Well, and it's so easy to not notice it, though. It's so easy for it to just kind of compound, and you don't. And I think that's where the depression kicks in, is because it's this feedback loop you're talking about that just gets deeper and deeper and worse and worse. It's nuts to me. I'll notice now, and I really pay attention to this stuff, like, where even when I'll just have like a week or two where I've been inconsistent, and inconsistency in the gym always results in worse choices of eating and just not getting what my body needs. And I don't really pay attention while that's happening. In fact, I think we intentionally ignore the signs as much as we possibly can. It's like, I know I'm not going in the gym right now, so I'm going to ignore how I feel, how I look, all those things like that. And then you find yourself sitting on the couch more, making poorer decisions, not being as active. And then I go get in the gym and I have a great workout, and instantly I'm walking with my chest out, and I'm better posture. I'm moving more. It causes me to be more active around the house and do more chores and get stuff done. I want to feed my body with better food because I know I just worked out, and I don't want to just cancel that great workout by eating a bunch of shit. Like, so it's amazing how compounding both negatively and positively that it can be, right?
Yeah, just the additional weight and everything pulling you forward, and like getting your shoulders to kind of come forward, getting your head to kind of come down, and just like being in a postural position like constantly where you're sort of just dragging, you know, down, and you're not as upright, and it definitely will affect your mood. I mean, just smiling in itself affects your mood. So it's easy to
knowing
think.
What we know about, you know, good health and how it impacts pretty much everything. I wonder how big of an impact it would have on everything, the world, if, let's look at America, for example. It's a wealthy country, so people do have access to, you know, fitness. They do have access to healthier food or whatever. We have access to a lot of food. What do you think, how big of an impact do you think it would have on just America if everybody just tried to make themselves healthier? Like, how big of an impact do you think that would have on everything?
Oh, yeah.
Business? On, you know, the economy.
A lot less bickering.
Less people probably fighting. People are in better moods.
Yeah.
It would, it's almost, you know, and I know we're fitness, so we think that tends to be the answer to everything. But I really do think that that's one of the answers to everything, because it's such a simple one.
Yeah, and it's
not that it's easy, but
it's controllable. It's empowering, because that's something that you can contribute towards every single day and improve upon. And so that has to affect everybody around you.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's really just one of the fundamental steps towards learning how to love yourself, which is essential if you're going to love others, especially another person. So I think that, you know, sometimes we overcomplicate what that looks like. You know, what's the best program? What's the best diet? At the end of the day, like, making a choice to take care of the body, the vessel that you're moving around in every day, has to be one of the most important decisions that you could ever make, long term, especially. Yeah. Right.
Think if, and if you think it from an esoteric standpoint, if you think that you're some, you're an energetic being, or you're a spirit or a soul, and this body is what you're traveling within, even if you think about it in that standpoint, your body, in that belief system or in that understanding, is the filter through which your energetic being or your soul connects to or interacts with the outside world. So that filter, you want it to be as clean as possible. Because if I'm receiving information from the world, the physical world, to my inner self, it's got to pass through this filter. And if I want to express myself out to the outside world, it has to also pass through that filter. Well, if that filter is covered in gunk and is just, you know, bad diet and just unhealthy and hormones are off or whatever, I'm not going to be able to receive the world in the most accurate way as possible, because it's the reality is your perception is your reality. How you perceive things is your truth. So people could be awesome around you. The world could be great around you. You could have everything going for you. But if you perceive it negatively, it's not going to seem that way at all. And on the flip side, you could have a very good heart. You could be a good person. But because your filter is so bad, what people are receiving from you is not accurate. It's not the goodness that's inside of you. And so even from an esoteric standpoint, one of the best things you could do is take care of this physical representation of yourself, and it'll make everything a lot easier. And I've seen this with time and time again with clients. The biggest changes I've ever had in clients, by the way, is not physical, but by far. I'm sure you guys can agree. The physical changes can be big, but they pale in comparison to the personal growth changes that I've seen in clients, especially the ones that I work with for years.
Yeah,
I remember having one client in particular who was working out with me, and he came to me from another person, and they all belonged to this big group that worked together. And I don't want to say where, because people know who I'm talking about, friends of mine who listen. But a lot of these people knew each other. So this guy came to me. I started training him. As soon as the other people found out I was training him, everybody was like, "Oh my God, I can't believe you're training so-and-so, he's such a dick, he's such an asshole." And he kind of was a little standoffish. Well, anyhow, as we trained together and the months rolled by and then they turned into years, this guy totally changed. He started feeling better about himself, had better energy, started hugging people. And people used to come up to me and say, "I don't know what you're doing with so-and-so, man, but he's a completely different person." And I remember telling him, I was like, "Well, it's not necessarily me that's doing anything, he feels better."
Well, yeah. Don't you think that part of that is like you start to subconsciously resent yourself, you know, because you're not taking care of yourself, and you fucking know it. Mm-hmm. Whether you think you know it or not, like you know it. Like it's like you know you're not. You're constantly feeding yourself crap. You're not moving around. You're not doing things that better you. I think you don't realize it, but you start to after a while. That starts to compound, and then it's like, you have this love,
oh yeah, and then you think everybody else is coming after you. Right. Like there's this weird protective sort of process where, you know, you're not feeling good about yourself. You think that everybody's noticing the same things that, you know, you're insecure about, and it just becomes this big wall you're trying to put out there to like block everybody.
Well, think about it this way. Have you ever been with your wife or your girlfriend, and you start arguing, and you're thinking in your mind like, "Oh, she's acting like whatever, or she's pissing me off." And then later you realize, I was just in a bad mood. Like, she really wasn't being any bad way towards me. It was just me being in a bad mood. You ever do that? You ever realize that?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
How hard is it to realize when you're in it?
And most of the time it's when I'm in pain. Like, yep. I've noticed that.
Totally.
Like, I remember I was like, I had like this real sharp pain, and then I was just like, it was just kind of like one of those that just all day long. You feel it, but then you forget about that you're in pain. You just like kind of go about your thing. And I just notice how short I'm being with everybody. Short, short, short. And then just snapping, you know, and like what? Why am I so harsh? Mm-hmm. And, you know, and so there's just multiple factors that contribute
and
to that.
It's so hard when you're in it. You can be in the bad mood and act a certain way, and someone could tell you you're just being in a bad mood, and you won't even hear that. Like, no, I'm not.
Right.
It's when you come out of the mood that you realize, oh, shit, I was in a bad mood. And the longer you're in a bad mood, the more difficult it is to realize that you're the problem and that's not everybody else. And then people start to react to you a certain way, and then it compounds and becomes worse and worse. So think of it this way. Not taking care of your health is putting yourself in a low-level bad mood all the time. Yeah. That's literally what's happening all the time. If you're not eating right and you're not exercising, not taking care of yourself, you're physically in a kind of constant bad mood. And what I mean by bad mood is if you look at your range of whatever your natural range of moods are, you're going to be in the lower part of it because you're just not healthy. Now think of how you react and receive from people and how you are towards other people and how everything around you appears.
Yeah.
And this is why they notice when people exercise and eat right that their performance goes up in school, at work,
everything
they perform
elevates
better.
A little bit.
It's all a part of it. So, and that's why when I read a study like that, it reminds me how hard it can be to get out of that hole in that cycle when you're like obese and unhealthy and then depressed because of it, but now that makes you want to not do exercise even more, want to eat worse even more, and just becomes a cycle. So it's a tough one.
Today's Quaw is brought to you by MAPS Anabolic. If you're looking to maximize your overall muscle and strength, MAPS Anabolic is the perfect place to start. With a full 30-day money-back guarantee, there is absolutely zero risk. So what are you waiting for? Go to mindpumpmedia.com and get started today.
It's the motherfucking Quaw.
The eagle has landed.
Quaw.
First question is from YTepJ. For packing on muscle, which is better, 5 days of isolation work or 3 days of full body lifting?
Oh, that's a layup for us.
For most people, it's the three full body day workouts.
For sure.
Yeah. They've done lots of studies on this, by the way, and they'll find that for the most part, it's the 3 days a week of full body routines that will give people more muscle. But really, you have to break down why.
Well, I mean, just the fact that he puts isolation work in there already, for sure, if you're Trump's that. If you're comparing isolation work to full body compound lifting, it's like...
I think maybe he means 5 days of like split body parts.
Probably.
Yeah.
But when you word it like that, it's like it's not even close call.
No,
like,
you know. Yeah.
Now, if you separated all those compound movements over 5 days, like that, then it depends a little bit more on the person, right? Who's going to respond that way? There's some people that respond.
I think the key is to hit your body parts between 2 to 4 days a week is what they're what studies have been showing pretty conclusively. That when they control for total volume, they control for the sets and exercises, and they control for everything, that you will build more muscle and respond and react faster to your workouts if you train each body part between 2 to 4 days a week. And so a lot of the 5 day a week split routines tend to hit the body once a week because you do like chest on one day and back on one day.
And then you end up going like super hard on that, you know, that one muscle group and thinking that you got all those days to recover, when in fact you're not getting as much volume with that strategy, you know, for that same muscle group. And you just tend to overdo it. And in the way that I used to train, and I actually used to do like some of these bodybuilder type workout routines, the split routines. And I just found, like, especially when it came to leg day, it was just so damn, like my legs, I just couldn't walk. And I thought that was how it had to be. And the rest of the week was like shot for me. So I was less productive even.
Right. And if you look at, so here's an easy comparison. Let's say I'm doing the 5 day split where I'm hitting one or two body parts a day and I'm only hitting each body part once a week. And let's say I'm doing chest on Monday and I'm doing 9 sets for my chest or 12 sets for my chest on that one day. What the workout would typically look like if I did 12 sets, so that's 4 exercises for 3 sets each, right? What that's typically going to look like is 1 or 2 big gross motor movement compound exercises.
Yeah, right. Like a barbell bench press, a dumbbell bench press, and then fucking cable flies and a machine pec deck.
Yes, because
strength.
At that point you're so fatigued, your chest is fatigued, you're no longer doing these big, super effective, because not all exercises are created equal. Some are far more effective than others, and you're going to build more chest muscle and strength with a barbell press than you will with a cable fly, right? Not to say that they don't have value, but
it's just a louder signal.
Yeah, and you're just getting fatigued now because you're doing 12 sets in one workout. Now let's imagine if I did 12 sets, but I divided that up over 3 workouts. So instead of hitting my chest once a week, I'm hitting my chest 3 days a week, and I'm doing 4 sets each time. Well, the exercises I'm going to pick each time are probably going to be the big ones. Because I'm only doing 4 sets, so I'm not going to just do 4 sets of cable, you know, flies. I'm probably going to do barbell presses or incline presses or dumbbell presses or things that are really effective because I'm fresh. I'm not as, you know, fatigued or whatever. And so the other benefit of doing a like 3-day full body type routine is you tend to do the best exercises all the time.
I also, in my experience, I also have found people that do the 5-day split routine over apply intensity and under apply frequency. When you end up splitting, you know, the muscle groups like that, it's really hard to attack them 2 to 3 times a week. Typically, some body part ends up suffering, you know, maybe because you care so much about your chest at that time, your chest gets enough of the frequency and volume, but then the other muscles suffer because you just are putting so much energy and effort into the chest. And then the other thing that ends up happening is because you are singling out a single muscle for an entire workout, you end up hammering the shit out of it intensity-wise. And then so then it suffers on the frequency side the next time you go to do it, if you even do it a second or third time that week. You just can't train it to the same capacity as you did the last work. Or you try to keep up that, and then you're over-applying the intensity. So that's kind of – I remember when you first sent over MAPS Anabolic to me, and it's just crazy how serendipitous everything has been for this business, because it was at that moment and that time in my life that I was really starting to piece this together that, man, I've been doing this split for so long. I've been teaching clients to do this for so long. But when I think about it, a lot of them aren't hitting the main principles that were really going to cause muscle growth the way you want. And in fact, what ends up happening is maybe for the first 2 or 3 weeks at best, somebody follows this split routine really well, and then they can't quite get to 5 days of the week. So then they end up stretching out to the next week. And so what ends up happening is they just don't hit the muscle groups frequently enough. And nothing would do that better than separating the body in either a full body routine or some sort of a split. Because that was what I was finding. At that time, I was starting to do an upper-lower split.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I remember you sent that over. And so my mind was already in that space on how important that this was to get this message out to a majority of people. Because for so long, I had been following the split type of routine. I was teaching people that, and they just weren't seeing the same results as if I were to take somebody and split their body in half or do a full body type of a routine.
Yeah, I remember when I first put it together for clients was before I put it together for myself. And it was because I would, every once in a while, I would get a client that was super hardcore and would train with me 4 or 5 days a week. So, okay, Sal, Monday through Friday, I want to train with you. I'm going to buy, you know, 100 sessions or whatever. And I'd be like, cool. And whenever I'd get a client like that, I'd be like, oh, great. I'm training them so often that I can do a split. I can do the one body part a week, you know, one body part a day, hit it once a week type of a split. Again, chest, back, shoulders, arms, and legs. That's how it typically would break out. And so I would do that, and the progress would be kind of – and then, you know, they would progress, but it wasn't like anything spectacular. And then at some point, these same clients – would say to me, you know, I want to back down to like 3 days a week and maybe work out on my own some days or whatever. And so what I started doing with these people is I'm only going to see you twice a week, then I'll do full body workouts with you. Why don't we just do that?
Right.
And then they'd get stronger and build more muscle. And I remember thinking, what the fuck? Like, this isn't supposed to happen.
Well, I was seeing clients that were working out less with me, seeing more results than my clients that were working out more with me.
Yeah.
That was like the big indicator, like, whoa. This client only sees me 2 days a week or 3 days a week. This other client's training 5 to 7 days a week. I know they're definitely bringing it. Why am I seeing way more results in this?
And that was the other thing. Like, I was training. I started to kind of transition into like full body workouts and using like even like suspension trainers. And I was all up in the latest like sports performance type, you know, rotational moves and all these things. And then when I had to break down, some of my clients were like, well, I can only do 2 to 3 times a week. I'm like, okay, well, I gave them the most like basic like squat, lunge, you know, bench press, overhead press, you know, and it was like a very basic, you know, like fundamental exercises that we focused on, and they got the best results. And I was like, oh shit.
Every time. And, and then that's what got me to start experimenting with myself. My body started responding well. And then I started reading a lot of the old muscle building magazines and old, you know, books before steroids really got big into bodybuilding. And I realized everybody trained that way. I remember going online and looking up Steve Reeves. He was a bodybuilder from the like 50s, 40s and 50s. And he played Hercules on TV, and he was this really good-looking, ridiculous proportion-looking bodybuilder. Like, you'd really want to look like him, very aesthetic. And so I looked up, what was Steve Reeves' routine? He worked out his whole body 3 days a week. Then I'm like, holy shit, what about this bodybuilder? What about this strength athlete? All from that era. They all did the same thing. You know, they would do full body 3 or 4 days a week. And then they would write and they would say to make sure you have some energy left over from your workout, which I interpreted as don't go to failure on every set. Started messing around with that stuff. And boy, everything just accelerated times a million. And so for most people, by the way, this might not be true for everybody, okay? But for most of you, hitting your whole body two to four days a week is going to be superior to doing the old one body part a day type split.
Next question is, I'm more than fitness. If or when would you ever use a hex bar over a straight bar for deadlifts? Also, would you deadlift and back squat in the same workout?
I'll tell you what.
Are you liking the hex bar now?
Well, no, not that.
I have one.
Okay. But just after hanging out with
Schlesinger.
Yes, Corey. I would totally use a hex bar for that now. I thought that was just a brilliant use of
for the explosive
for
cleans.
Athletes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What a brilliant, brilliant idea. So if you haven't listened to Corey Schlesinger's episode, have we released that yet?
No.
Okay, that's so why they haven't listened to it.
Yeah.
Where are you at with that? Yeah. Come on.
So that should be coming out any day now. So that'll come out. That, and we talk about how he uses a hex bar for
power.
What a cool way to do it.
I mean, basically,
very smart.
You're getting in the hex bar and you're doing like you would do a squat, like you would do a deadlift, but you're exploding up and doing it as a power movement. So it's an advanced exercise, but way easier to do than like a power clean.
Yeah.
When you're working for power. I love the hex bar. I call it the trap bar. Same thing.
Yeah.
But I absolutely love it. When my deadlift gets stagnant, I'll switch to the trap bar. I can lift more weight on the trap bar, anywhere between 45 to 55 more pounds than I can on straight bar. And so when I'm hitting PRs, I can usually hit that weight first with the trap bar, and then it gets me closer to it on the straight bar. It's easier on the lower back. Because it's
neutral grips, my favorite part.
Yeah, it's easier to hold on to because it's neutral grips. It's safer. It's biomechanically easier. Mm-hmm. So when you look at the complexity and the skill and, required to do a deadlift, it's much higher than to do a deadlift with a trap or a hex bar. A hex bar, in fact, I would say, if you're a beginner and you want to learn how to deadlift,
I tend to steer beginners in that direction just because. And two, you can recruit more help in terms of like getting your anterior chain like a little bit more involved, getting the quads in there as well. So I like it because it's such a full encompassing exercise. Like you get everything, your whole body's involved with it. And the technique of it, like you said, with just, the regular straight bar, there's a lot more there to coach as far as coaching mm-hmm. points are concerned. So I do like to use it with just people that are in it for, are just starting out.
Yeah. That's how I taught myself. That's how I taught myself the deadlift.
That's how I'm going to start my son.
Yeah. On a hex bar is great. It's just a great way to get to really, when you're holding that in a neutral grip, it's easier to keep the chest up, the shoulders retracted back. So the emphasis that you have to put on the upper body in comparison to a barbell, I think, is a lot less. You can really concentrate on the hinging of the hips, right? And then driving up through their heels. I like it for those reasons. Now, the question also asks if we would do this in the same workout.
Well, it says squat and deadlift in the same workout.
Yeah, no.
I almost never.
Yeah. Now that, rarely.
Now, I think we all agree on that. Now, that being said, does it mean that I've never done it or I never would ever do it? I just would not make a habit of it because one of them is going to suffer
exactly.
for sure.
Yeah, you're going to compromise performance on one of those just because they're so involved.
Even if we forget the performance compromise, it's in my experience, it's a recipe for injury.
Injury. Yeah.
Yeah, because you're looking at lots of posterior chain overload. You're looking at two exercises that are very technical. And here's the thing with exercises. They all have the risk factor. And some exercises, you can be loose with form and the risk of injury doesn't go up that much. Like an easy example would be like a curl. If I do curls with perfect form, let's say my risk factor on a scale of 1 to 10 is, a 2. And then my form is loose, it's now like a 2.25 or 2.5. It doesn't really go up that much. Now with a squat, if my form is perfect, my risk may be just a 2 in terms of injury. if my form is off just by a little bit, it jumps up already to a 5 or 6. And if my form is off by a moderate amount, now I'm like a high risk, because squats are high risk exercise when your form isn't perfect. Same thing with the deadlift. The deadlift, if you have good form, good mechanics, good control, very safe. If it's off even by a little bit, especially if you're lifting heavy, you're asking for trouble. Well, what you're doing when you're combining squats and deadlifts, you're fatiguing a lot of the same area. And the second, you know, round of going through them, your risk of injury goes through the roof. I definitely wouldn't deadlift before squatting, that's for sure. Like if I did them both in the same workout, it's squat first, deadlift second.
It's kind of like why I don't ever do like a flat barbell bench press and then an incline barbell bench press. I'll typically move over to dumbbells or do something else with that workout. Like whenever I do a barbell movement, you know, for a certain muscle group or area, there's one big barbell movement, and then I tend to move over to like dumbbells or or some sort of an isolation type of movement exercise.
To that point, like doing like a bench press, like a flat bench press, to then an overhead press right after that. Like for me, I don't see myself, you know, doing well with that either, in terms of like managing, because I'm already trying to manage my positioning in my back and like where I could be compromised. I don't want to be fatigued going into that movement, you know, to where I have to be extra cautious of that.
Yeah.
And when you're looking at the posterior chain, especially your control of your spine, you really don't want to fatigue that too much and then go heavy. Again, you're asking for problems. And squatting and deadlifting, they're big fucking movements. They're among the top.
Where I could see, and where I think I've done stuff like this, is let's say I'm in a squat today, right? And I go in today, I'm going to go kind of heavier squatting. But then because maybe deadlifts have been an area that I'm trying to work on mechanically and I'm doing something, maybe I'll go real lightweight and I'm just perfecting my form and I'm just working on my grip, my setup. Like this is where there's always an exception to the rule and like everything that we talk about. Like, no, I would never program deadlifts and squats in the same workout unless I happen to be on this kick right now where I'm really trying to practice one of those movements all the time.
That's a good point.
And then so I might be doing it almost every day, something around it, but I'm just not. It's all about how you manage your intensity. Like the worst thing that you could do, in my opinion, is go heavy squat, heavy deadlift in the same routine, because then like Sal's saying, you're really taking a chance there. But if I'm heavy deadlifting, but then I'm also trying to work on my squat mechanics and I'm just doing the barbell on my back or 135, which is very controllable and easy for me, but I'm working on technique and my foot positioning and things like that, like I could see value in that and I could justify why I would have both those in my routine.
No, that's a very fair point, because you could do squats and deadlifts together, and one workout the squat be real easy and the deadlift be heavy, and the next workout the squat be heavy and the deadlift be easy. Mm-hmm. I mean, you could definitely do that. You just have to be very careful, like you said, and monitor the intensity.
Next question is from AD Good. Love to hear your opinions on weight belts, wrist wraps, etc. I know it makes sense for power lifters, but what about those of us just lifting for general health and aesthetics?
This has been one that we've talked about, but we haven't talked about
new listener.
We haven't talked about this in a long time.
You know, if you're a competitive lifter, I could see how you'd want to lift with a weight belt or wrist wraps if they're in your sport. Like if you're a strongman, for example, strongman competitors they're able to use weight belts and wrist wraps. Power lifters are able to use weight belts. For the average lifter just looking to be fit and healthy, there really is no need and really no benefit other than you're just going to lift heavier. Yeah. But here's what you want to consider. When you're lifting with a lifting aid like a weight belt or wrist wrap, you are getting good at your lift with those aids attached. And they literally change how your body operates. Like a weight belt is a great example. If I put a weight belt on, the reason why I can lift more weight with a weight belt is because it creates artificial core stability. Mm-hmm. When I have a thick weight belt on and I'm putting it on real tight, my core will push out against the belt to create the stable core, and now I can lift much more weight. Now, what ends up getting trained when I do that over and over again? Well, what it does is it trains my core to stabilize by pushing out. Yeah. The second I take the belt off, let's say I do this for years, and every time I go heavy, I wear my belt. Every single time I go heavy, I wear my belt. I take the belt off and I try and lift heavy without the belt, it's going to be a much bigger detriment than it was before because now my body is confused on how to brace without a weight belt.
It even changes you psychologically too. I mean, like going and approaching that weight, if you don't have like your wrist straps, you don't have your belt, like it's going to change the way that, you know, you're just going to be more cautious, you know, in the lift, which could then be detrimental because it's something that you're overthinking. And for me, I've always just wanted to make sure that if I'm lifting a weight, I should be able to do that without anything. I just don't, other than the fact that if I'm trying to like impress somebody or I'm trying to go for a PR or something like that, I could see, you know, having, you know, some kind of like belt or wrist. But even since I've trained so long without them, it's a foreign animal to me. Yeah. So it doesn't really make a lot of sense in the way that my mechanics are established.
Yeah, I like using a belt when I go really, really heavy on deadlifts and sometimes on squats. Why? Is it to keep my spine safe? Yeah, with the weight that I'm using. So I remember years ago I was doing this and I was, you know, pulling 500 pounds and doing all this weight, and my buddy didn't use belts. And he says, why do you use a weight belt? I'm like, oh, it helped keep me safe because I'm lifting heavier. He goes, you know what else keeps you safe? If you don't wear the belt and then handle a weight that you can handle without the belt.
Right.
And I mean, that's 100% true. Why do I wear a belt? My ego likes lifting the heavier weights. That's really that's the true answer, because the truth is I could take the belt off and just go with the weight that I could, that my core state can stabilize.
You can literally distill it all the way down to that.
It's what it all boils down to. Is there a benefit for muscle growth? I mean, you're splitting hairs, but the really, really advanced trainee can find ways of using these tools to maximize hypertrophy in other parts of their body, like wrist wraps. You know, I might be able to really fatigue my back. My hands might give out more, so I'm going to use those to work my back out. I threw wrist wraps out a long time ago, and it took me a year before my hands could catch up to the rest of my back. And now there isn't a weight that I can lift that my hands can't hold on to.
So I'm glad you finished on that statement, because I'm going to come from the other side and say that I have knee wraps, wrist wraps, belt, shoes, bands, all of these in my bag, in my gym bag. And my gym bag comes with me anytime I go to lift. Now, I treat it the same way that we talk about drop sets, we talk about chains, we talk about bands. They're all tools. And I can find a place to use all of these tools, and I still do find a place to use them. Now, you will never probably ever see me go back-to-back workouts using any or all of these tools. I have found times, you touched on a few right there, like, where do I use my wrist wraps? Well, there's certain times where my forearms are completely gassed from doing heavy deadlifts, and now I'm doing like a rear delt fly on something, and I don't even want my forearms anymore involved. Like I don't want to give out on the movement because my forearms are gassed out because I gassed them out from the deadlifts, and I really care about sculpting my rear delts, and so that's all I'm trying to do is isolate that area, and so I want to try and take my forearms out of it because of what I just did prior to that. Now, that doesn't happen a lot of the times, but it has happened before, and that's why I carry them in my bag for that exact reason of like, oh, you know what? I wanted to make sure I hit some flies, but fuck, my forearms are so burnt out. I'm not going to be able to grab this weight or do that. Fuck it. I got my wraps in there. I'm going to use that. Or I've even used belts on exercises where normally I wouldn't use a belt because I overreached the day before doing squats and my low back is completely fried, and now I'm about to do something else that might incorporate my low back, and so I'm going to crutch it there and I'm going to use it that one time. So there's been my squat shoes. I've got really good range of motion now. I've got really good ankle mobility, although it still is a limiting factor being a 6'3" guy to hit a deep, deep bottom squat. And so there's times when I'm stretching myself and I'm squatting a weight that I haven't squatted in a really long time, and for safety reasons, I want to have that on there because I know that's a limiting factor for me. If there's going to be a breakdown in my squat, it's going to be at the very bottom where I start to, where my heels will want to rise or my feet will want to pronate. And so when I have the squat shoes, I've got that extra 2 inches that gives me that safety of not allowing that to happen. So there's been times where I can use this. Now, that's the thing, though. Like the other examples I gave of the drop sets, the supersets, the chains, they're tools. It can be used as a tool.
what ends up happening with a lot of these tools, including the chains and the drop sets and all the crazy training like that, is people get, you know, they get stuck in doing it all the time, or they feel it looks cool, or it makes them feel like a serious lifter, because power lifters have the opportunity to wear belts and straps and this and that. Therefore, when I have my, or like men's physique athletes now that walk around wearing their belts on isolation exercises and fucking machine exercises, which I think is ridiculous. And so now it's become trendy because I'm a, you know, a men's physique athlete and I have my name on the back of my belt. I wear it on all exercises, even when I'm doing arms and bullshit. I think that's silly. I don't think it serves a legitimate purpose to wear it at those times. But I think all of them can be tools, and I have found places where I have used those, just like I use my BFR straps occasionally. Like, I don't recommend that be something that replaces your good strength exercises, but there's been times where I bust those straps out and I train BFR. So It's a tool, and they're all tools, and you don't want to wear them all the time, or you look like a tool.
Yeah, very true. I am never recommended.
Don't be a tool. Use the tool.
I almost never recommended those four clients. I just didn't, unless somebody was super like advanced or were having fun and messing with things. But you know, you want to be able to, you want to build your strength in a way that really is, it's because your body is that strong, because that's what's going to give you the carryover into the real world. It really doesn't matter if you can squat, you know, 30 more pounds when you have a belt on, when you don't wear a belt most of the time. You see what I'm saying? And I know this, and I wear the weight belt, again, because it allows me to add 50 pounds to my lift, because I've gotten really... That's another thing, by the way. Just throwing a belt on isn't going to make you lift more, by the way. There's actually a technique to wearing a belt. In fact, for first-timers sometimes putting a belt on, they can't squat. They have difficulty moving or whatever. Yeah. There's a technique to it. But yeah, I don't see any benefit for general health or aesthetics, except for the super body-aware advanced people like Adam, or people who compete in competitions that use those things.
Yeah, I've never recommended it to a client. So I just want to put that out there. Like, I have all the tools, I use all tools, but it's I don't think it's necessary at all. Although, in defense of all these tools, I have always found places.
You're defending the tools?
Yeah, I'm defending the tools
right now.
The tools
that use the tools.
Oh, yeah. Nice. I probably use my wrist wraps the least. In fact, I can't remember the last time that I did. I know I gave that analogy, but I haven't been bodybuilding in a long time to where I would, so I don't really give a shit about it. That's the other thing too. It's like the difference that it's going to give me is so incremental, and you're risking the, like you're saying, that the fact that you want to be able to pick up that weight anyways naturally, like you shouldn't have to use straps. The only place where that ever made sense for me that much was when I was sculpting my physique, that I didn't give a fuck if somebody came over to me and said, like, oh, you're not real naturally strong. I don't give a shit. I'm trying to build fucking balloon-looking shoulders. Like, if this is going to help me do that and not fatigue my forearms, which my judge doesn't give two shits about, then I'm going to do it no matter who makes fun of me. So I think there is a place for them, and I can argue places to use them, but it's a tool. It's not something that should be in your workout every workout.
Next question is from S. Zoll SC. When figuring out maintenance calories, do you average each week of tracking? My weight seems to fluctuate throughout the week when weighing myself every day.
Okay, so almost looks like two things I want to answer here. The first one is your weight's fluctuating throughout the week. Most people's weight fluctuates throughout the week, more so for women than for men. But that can be determined on, you know, amount of carbohydrates you ate, the amount of fluids that you drank, your digestion.
Sodium.
Yeah, sodium. And this all has to do with your you know, how much water you can hold or not. And I can gain or lose 5 pounds with the snap of a finger from just manipulating my body's water. That's real easy. As far as figuring out calories, this is a good one. You know, when I work with clients now, especially if I'm putting someone on a cut, I like to have people have different calorie days. So if I figure for this person that I want to have them eat 1,500 calories a day, or let's say 2,000 calories is a real easy round number. Let's say I want them to eat 2,000 calories a day. The way I figure it out is I don't have them eat 2,000 calories every day. I figure out for the week. The whole week I have 14,000 calories. And then what I do is I fluctuate their calories. Some days are 1,500 calories. Other days are 2,500 calories. Other days are 1,800 calories. And other days are 2,200 calories. And the reason why I do that is twofold. One, the psychological. Psychologically speaking, having some calorie, some days be higher calories and other days be lower calories, more closely mimics real life. Real life is not the exact same calories every single day. Just doesn't work that way. And if I'm working with someone to help them get to a point where they can just have a healthy lifestyle and don't have to necessarily track every single day, then I want to mimic what real life is like, which is some days are higher, some days are lower. At the end of the week, it's the same total, but we're fluctuating. So that's number one. And it also gives them more variety on the higher days, and on the lower days, they get to deal with hunger a little more. But here's the other reason, especially when you're cutting. When you're cutting calories, your body is always trying to adapt and slow its metabolism down to accommodate. Your body doesn't like the fact that you're tapping into fat stores. It doesn't want to. It wants to hold on to the fat. And so it will slow its metabolism down to make up the difference. This is why we always advocate for people lifting weights. Lift weights speeds up your metabolism, or at least it maintains your metabolism more, so it doesn't slow down as much when you're trying to cut. Well, there's something else that also helps mitigate that metabolic adaptation, and that's undulating your calories. Mm-hmm. Bodybuilders have known this for a long time. They'll cut and they'll have cheat days, and they'll find benefits from it. The benefits from it are the fact that they had a day that wasn't so low a calorie, and the body kind of felt like it didn't need to hold on as much. And so some studies will show that people's metabolisms don't adapt as strongly downward when people cut with calories that tend to fluctuate.
Now, I do this different, because I too undulate calories, but I don't do that when I'm trying to figure out maintenance. When I'm trying to figure out maintenance, I actually want to take as many variables out of the equation as I possibly can. So I always recommend to a client, first of all, I ask them to get their step counter or Fitbit or whatever tool they use to track their steps prior to meeting with me, so they can already get an idea of what a high day of movement, what a low day of movement kind of looks like. And then I ask them also to track their food to get just an idea of what they're consuming. And then we kind of agree upon a number. And so I normally look at someone's food and I go, okay, and we'll use round numbers like Sal did. The week's gone by, you tracked your food, you tracked your steps, and over the week's time, it looks like you're averaging, you know, just for argument's sakes, we're going to say 10,000 steps a day on average, and you're consuming 2,000 calories is what your average is. Now, I know that I'm going to have you do that again this week and keep you at the kind of minimal amount of steps. So if I looked at your steps and saw that's your average, I typically want you to move the lower end of that for the first week that we're trying to figure out maintenance. And I want your calories to stay the same. And I know that day to day, your weight's going to go up and down, but I'm looking at it from the 7 days to 14 days apart if we've kind of stayed the same. Now, if you stay the same and you don't go up or down very much, I know that we've found your maintenance calories. Now, from there is what we start to manipulate, either undulating, adding exercise, reducing calories, potentially adding calories. That all depends on what I see and where you're at. If you're a, you know, 250-pound guy and you're only eating 2,000 calories and your body's maintaining, well, that's a big red flag for me that your metabolism is extremely slow and I need to introduce more calories. We need to reverse diet you. Now, if you're eating 2,000 calories and you're a 115-pound girl, that's a pretty healthy metabolism. I could probably take some calories from you and begin your cutting process. So it really depends on who I'm talking to, what their maintenance calories are when we first start out, from where I go from there as far as introducing more calories and also how much exercise that I introduce. But as far as the day-to-day, I mean, including myself, I see clients go from fluctuating 1 pound as high as 9. I used to fluctuate 9 pounds through the night when I was competing, when I was eating 6-plus meals a day and 5,000 plus calories.
So you would lose 9 pounds at night while you were sleeping?
Yeah.
Just sweating nine pounds up?
6 to 9, normal. Wow. Total normal. Yeah. Anything less than that was crazy.
It's a greasy pillow.
It was just straight water coming out of me. I mean, when you're eating 5,000 calories, I'm consuming 500 to 600 grams of carbohydrates. I'm eating or I'm drinking 1.5 to 2 gallons of water a day. I mean, the amount of water that my body's holding and losing every single night is crazy. So I don't really don't worry about the fluctuation up or down. You're looking at the, you know, at the end of the week. Yeah, did you stay about the
same weight loss or fat loss? It doesn't move consistently downward. It typically looks like a stepladder. Like, you know, I start at 150, goes down to, you know, 148, up to 151, 147, 146, 148, you know, kind of goes up and down, but it trends downward. That's what you want to see. I misunderstood the question. I think what you said was the right answer. When you're trying to figure out maintenance, you do want to be consistent,
yeah,
because you have to take all the variables out. I misunderstood it as
I figured you did, because yeah. I was like, yeah, when we're first trying to figure out maintenance, no. I don't want a lot of movement, but I do agree with you that once I do figure
out,
when
we're trying to cut, then I move people
right, then we start undulating calories and things like that. But then again, you know, whether you're trying to cut or not, I don't necessarily cut everybody that wants to cut. Just because you hire me and you say, Adam, I want to lose 30 pounds, doesn't necessarily mean that I'm going to give you what you want when I first meet you, because I might find out that if you might have been example A, you're a 250-pound male and you're only eating 2,000 calories.
And you're like, I want to lose weight.
Yeah, and you want to lose weight. Like, sure, I could reduce you to 1,500. We might lose a couple pounds, but your body will adapt to that. And then what the fuck are you going to do? 250-pound guy eating 1,500 calories. That's just ridiculous.
What's the longest you've ever worked with someone before you could put them on a cut?
A year.
Wow.
Yeah, a year.
Just a year of slow reverse dieting.
Yeah, a year. A year of slow reverse dieting, and then like what I
like
tend
little
to,
mini cuts?
Yeah, a little mini, because I want to see, like, let's see how their body's responding, and plus break up the monotony of me constantly telling them we got to add. But yeah, no, I had a girl one time that was about 100 pounds overweight, and she was only eating like 1,300, 1,500 calories. And it took a really long time for me to even get her up to like the 2,200 calorie range before I could even ask. And normally what I'll do with someone like that is just to show them that we're making progress as far as rebuilding metabolism, is after I've had them like consistent for a couple months, I'll just like drop down for a few days and like show them like a quick drop. Like, see how responsive your body's starting to get.
Yeah.
It wasn't that way before. We get, just trust me, we gotta keep going this way. But yeah, no, some people take a really long time. I've got somebody right now that I'm helping. I threw the number around 250 like that in 2000 because it rang a bell, because the guy that I'm talking about right now is in his 20s and was only eating 2,000 calories, and he's 250. He's over 250, and you know, he's not losing weight at that. So right now it's been constantly. What's kind of cool too is I'm always having to talk to him about adding calories, eat more calories, good calories, right? But more calories. You don't need to train that much. No cardio. Walking is the only thing I want you doing. And what's kind of neat is I told him from the very beginning that our goal is not to lose weight. I don't want to see like this big drop, but and I'll show you guys pictures. I actually have pictures of him on my phone. He just sent them to me. His body composition, it's pretty rad to see the difference. You know, he's literally not moved, but I think he's like 0.8 is the difference in his scale. And for 3 months now, he's been trying to slowly increase calories. But when you look at the difference in his body, and I'll show you guys just a minute, his body.
Yeah, I've always found that, you know, when we're trying to get that baseline in maintenance, that's been the most challenging process with clients, because they either come in with the goal of being in a deficit or a surplus. They're not in a goal to find out and recognize all their patterns that they've established throughout, you know, their week, their month, their years. And, you know, just doing that, it takes a while. So to be able to convince them that that's all part of the process.
But boy, it's a hard conversation it is to talk to somebody and be like, look, I know we've been doing this for 6 months and you came to me wanting to lose 30 pounds, but we can't because,
we got some work.
Yeah, because your metabolism's still too slow.
Yeah.
You know, that's a very difficult thing to tell somebody. Definitely. Or it's a difficult thing to sell to somebody because they just don't want to buy it, you know? And I end up doing what you said, Adam, is I'll put them on these little mini cuts just to make them happy and show them.
Right, just show
some progress.
You have to. Otherwise, they just get – it's very rare I would get somebody who just blindly trusted me for that long, because they're putting the work in, man. They're putting the discipline in to be consistent. They're trying hard. They're fighting coming out of depression, yada, 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 all this stuff going on with them. And they just want to feel better, and to not see the scale move is really a mental fuck. But that's why it's so important, you know, to take. That's why I like pictures. And I remember when I first told him to take the picture, and that's 2 weeks after he started, and he was like, you know, I don't want. He just doesn't even want to look at himself. And I'm like, no, I want you to have it, just because there's going to come a time in about 2 or 3 months where you're probably going to be about the same weight, which is exactly where we're at right now, exact same weight. But I promise you, I'm going to be able to show you a physical change that's different, even if you don't think you feel it. And it's funny because I had him send them to me, right? So I just had him send those photos to me. He hasn't gone back and looked at them.
he's just telling me how he, like, yeah, no, I feel better. You know, I feel like my shoulder's a little more broad and my waist is kind of coming down a little bit, but I don't feel like I've changed much. And then, like, he sent him over. I'm like, bro, you've changed so much and you're the exact same weight. You know how awesome that is? Like, what a body composition you've changed. Like, you're doing beautiful, man.
You know, when it comes to fluctuating calories, I like to do that on a bulk, too. I find that the benefit of the fluctuating the calories on a cut is the benefit of the higher calorie days. Mm-hmm. The benefit on the bulk is the lower calorie days because, and I know some people listening are going to be like, ah, I wish I was in that situation. But let me tell you, when you're trying to put on muscle size and you're eating 3,000 and 4,000 calories.
It's a chore, man.
And it's not happening. You know, one of the best things you could do is go on a little tiny cut or throw in some low calorie days, resensitize your body to those calories. Start eating them again and then watch what happens. Your body just responds. Some of the best gains I've ever had came after a prolonged fast, for example, because my body was primed for them.
So receptive for those nutrients.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So look, I want to remind everybody, Black Friday sale starts now.
Holy moly macaroni.
50% off all programs, all of our programs. You got to go to mapsfitnessproducts.com and use the code BFPROGRAMS. That's Black Friday programs, BF programs. Also, all bundles. Bundles are where we combine multiple MAPS programs and discount them, are discounted further. 25% off all bundles. Use the code BF bundles. Again, the code for the individual programs is BF programs. That's for 50% off. The code for bundles at 25% off is BF bundles. Just go to mapsfitnessproducts.com.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.